Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar series, where great professors teach you. My name is Richard Poe, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Dante and His Divine Comedy. Your professor is Timothy Shutt of Kenyon College. Professor Shutt earned his B.A. in English Literature at Yale and his Ph.D. in Medieval Literature and the History of Ideas at the University of Virginia. Since 1986, Professor Shutt has taught in the English department and in the college's unique integrated program in human studies, an interdisciplinary program which focuses on the great books of literature, philosophy, history, art history, religion, and science. In addition to numerous academic publications, Shutt has also written extensively on military history, baseball, and birding. Dante's Divine Comedy is one of the greatest and most inspiring literary works ever written. It may come as a surprise because Dante is best known for the Inferno, the first cantica of the Commedia, which is, by any standard, fairly grim. If you think of Dante with the Inferno primarily in mind, it may be hard to imagine what it is that makes the Commedia such an enduring and moving work of art. But the Commedia, as a whole, is about the afterlife, not just hell, but purgatory and heaven, too. Dante's genius is the genius of the allegorical method. In talking about his journey through hell, purgatory, and heaven, Dante is talking about the whole course of human life. The Commedia is, in the first instance, an account of Dante's own salvation. In midlife, he was beset by troubles. He was a reasonably prosperous and highly esteemed Florentine citizen who suddenly lost everything in a coup engineered by his enemies. Dante descended into doubt and depression. The Commedia chronicles how he got out. But in chronicling his own recovery, indeed his salvation, Dante not only provides us with an autobiography, he also suggests that not only the problems he confronts, but the means by which he overcomes them are in some sense universal. He is talking not just about himself, but about everybody. In talking about his salvation, he is also talking about the salvation of his readers. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and, yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Dante and His Divine Comedy. Lecture 1, Dante, His Life and Times. And now, Professor Shutt.
Le cose tutte quante hanno ordine tra loro. E questo è forma che l'universo a Dio fa semigliante.
That, I take it, is the central theme statement, or something very, very close to it, of Dante's Divine Comedy. And I quote it here at the beginning because the ideas that he there expresses, in a certain sense, set the perimeters for the whole arc, not only of the Commedia, but in some sense express the guiding assumptions which governed him throughout the whole course of his work and his life. Let me translate. All things whatsoever have order among themselves. We live in an ordered universe. E questo, and that very order, questo è forma che l'universo a Dio fa semigliante. And that structure of the world, is the form, Platonic language here, the form which makes the universe resemble God. Dante's fundamental assumption. The universe for Dante is theomorphic, God-shaped, is a physical, tangible expression, insofar as such a thing is possible, of God himself, which means, and this is crucial to the program pretty much all the way through, that revelation, that an awareness of God's presence for Dante can begin anywhere. Dante claims right at the beginning of the third portion or cantica of his Divine Comedy, the Paradiso. Nel ciel che più della sua luce prende fu io. I was in the heaven that most receives God's light, his light. I was in that heaven. A vision in that sense authorizes Dante's claims throughout the Commedia. And the Commedia, of course, is Dante's major work. In fact, I would argue, and this is not hopelessly eccentric, but probably not universal consensus, I would argue, and I wouldn't be alone in arguing, that Dante's Commedia, the divine, was added later, 2 centuries later. The Commedia is probably the single greatest, most all-embracing, far-reaching, whatever you want to say, luminous, inspiring, at least from some perspectives, the greatest single literary work ever composed. To me, the closest rival is, I suppose, the Odyssey of Homer, whoever Homer was, and that in itself is an interesting question. And certainly, many would argue that the works of Shakespeare, taken as a whole, are greater and further reaching. I wouldn't want one way or another to get into that. But even if we concede that much, still, as a single work, the Commedia stands supreme. And in a way, I suppose that's surprising, because from the outside, from a distance at least, lots of people think of the Commedia as being mainly about hell and horrible tortures and Dante's inflicting revenges, imaginary revenges on the people that he disapproves of and dislikes. And none of that sounds terribly edifying. And it also is widely taken, and rightly taken, as the supreme expression of a medieval Christian humanist worldview, which is a worldview, we have to be honest about this, that certainly doesn't gain universal allegiance now. So why is the Commedia anything other than a museum piece, an artifact of another time and another place? Well, 2 reasons that I would propose for it. First of all, to think of the Commedia as focusing primarily on hell is a fundamental mistake. Hell is in some ways the most vivid part of it, I suppose necessarily so, but it's 1/3 of it, and it is the bottom 1/3 of it. It's the 1/3 that deals with failure. To focus on the inferno alone would be, in a sense, equivalent to trying to gain an idea of the intellectual life of a college by studying the sanctions which are imposed on people who are flunking out. They're there, but they're not the point. In fact, they're ways of dealing with fundamental failures to address the point. So too in Dante. Second, beyond the point being the total and complete fulfillment of human potentiality in all imaginable guises, Dante's moral vision, his conceptualization of human aspiration, what motivates us and how we can fail to fulfill our deepest yearnings, all of that, generations of readers, Christian, non-Christian, non-believers alike, all that generations of readers have found profoundly level-headed, sane, and in its own odd way, moderate, and once again, deeply, deeply inspiring. This sounds implausible, but every year I teach a course in the Commedia to a large number of students, sometimes 100 or more at a pop, and many of them tell me years later, now one has to take such claims with a grain of salt, I suppose, but that it really clarified their own thinking and helped them deal with their own lives. Really and truly, we all get a chance, Dante implies, we all get a chance to find our Beatrice, and she is something very much worth finding. Well, our format here will be this in the course to follow. In order to understand the Commedia and to understand the rest of Dante's works, which we'll be alluding to at least tangentially, we need to understand Dante's life because, among other things, the Commedia is a sort of spiritual autobiography of Dante. And we also need to understand his political context. He lived a lively and, in some respects, an unfortunate political life, and political concerns, the welfare of Italy, the welfare, finally, of the world, were of ongoing and profound concern to him. So our strategy will be this. I'll start now by talking a bit about his life and times in this first lecture. Then we'll move on to the overall structure of the Commedia as a whole. And then in the subsequent lectures, we'll go through it section by section and piece by piece. Dante was born in Florence sometime probably in May, certainly under the sign of Gemini, in 1265. He came from the lower level nobility, not terribly wealthy, but wealthy enough, not one of the big players on the Florentine scene, but nonetheless a family of some consequence. His father's name was Alighiero, Dante Alighieri, hence. His mother's name was Bella degli Abbati, or Gabriella, actually. He was the oldest child. He had a younger sister, and then his mother died when he was about 7 years old. His dad lived on into Dante's early teens, and in the meantime, remarried and had another son and two daughters. So Dante grew up in a fairly extensive family. Italian neighborhoods and Florentine neighborhoods during the Middle Ages were very, very small. And lots of people who proved to be prominent in Dante's later life lived a house or two down the street, or in the case of his wife-to-be, literally not just next door, but in a house with a shared wall right behind where Dante lives. The name of his wife was Gemma Donati. They were betrothed when Dante was, believe it or not, 12 years old, for a good dowry, of course. And the Donatis were influential people. When Dante got married is a little bit less clear. There's lots of information about Dante's early life. That's not the problem. The problem is that it doesn't agree precisely on dates, depending on who you want to follow. So at some point in his late teens or early 20s, he and Gemma got married, and they had, in fact, four children. Giovanni first, who sort of falls out of the picture, and then Pietro and Jacopo shortly thereafter. Pietro later wrote one of the very first commentaries on his dad's great poem. And finally, a daughter, Antonia, who went to live with her dad in his relatively old age and joined a convent, interestingly enough, as we'll see, taking the conventual name of Beatrice when she did so. Antonia's choosing of the conventual name of Beatrice when she entered what the Middle Ages would have called an explicitly religious life is very interesting and bespeaks a kind of, what, moral generosity on Antonia's part, because the love of Dante's life, of tremendous importance for pretty much all his work, and certainly the Commedia, is not his wife Gemma, to whom, so far as we know, he was faithful, who finally went to live with him in old age after he'd long been in exile. She couldn't before that time, but was instead a young woman of his own age who lived right down the street, whose name in Italian is Beatrice Beatrice Portinari. Beatrice Portinari. The name is interesting, and Dante himself makes a good deal of it. It means bringer of blessings, as in words like beatitude or beatify, to make a saint, the state of holiness. Beatrice was, to Dante, so he believed, a bringer of blessings, and it began when her father had a party, when Dante was almost at the end of his ninth year, and Beatrice was just beginning hers. That was, as Dante describes it in the first section of the Vita Nuova, the early work of poetry and commentary, which made him the most famous poet in Italy long before he'd written the Commedia. Seeing Beatrice when he was 9 years old was for him, he says, the beginning of a new life. Incipit vita nova. Here's what he says. She appeared to me almost in the beginning of her ninth year, and I first saw her near the end of my ninth year. She appeared dressed in the most noble of colors. He's right about the most noble of colors, I think. A subdued and decorous crimson, girded and adorned in a style suitable to her years. At that moment, and what I say is true, the vital spirit, the one that dwells in the most secret chamber of the heart, began to tremble so violently that even the least pulses of my body were strangely afflicted. And trembling it, the vital spirit spoke these words, "Here is a God stronger than I who shall come to rule over me." Dante fell, so he tells us, in his ninth year, hopelessly and utterly in love with Beatrice, and he claims that that love was deeply edifying, and this is the astonishing thing. He sticks with this all the way through the Commedia. He claims that for him, the beginning of his redeemed religious life was his encounter with this exquisitely beautiful nine-year-old girl. He makes astonishing claims for her effect on him, and so he argues on others. In a canzone, later on in the Vita Nuova, he claims, when she walks, love drives a killing frost into vile hearts that freezes and destroys their every thought. And dare a thought remain to look at her, it has to change to good, or else must die. This, too, has God Almighty graced her with. Whoever speaks with her shall speak with him. So, for Dante, Beatrice is this ongoing walking manifestation of grace, transforming, in his view, and transforming for the good, the psyches and inclinations of everyone that she encounters. He arranges her life in the decisive moments of his encounters with her in a series of nines, and he goes on to say in a very elaborate passage that Beatrice herself is a nine. Not in the, forgive me mentioning such things, frat boy sense of really, 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 really good looking, though she was assuredly that, but in the sense that nine is three, the Trinitarian number times three, and so that she is a nine in the sense of, again, a miraculous manifestation of divine power in the world. And if you recall right at the beginning, I said that anything in Dante's world can, to some degree, does to some degree reveal God, but Beatrice did so for Dante in an especially vivid and life-transforming way. He met her when she was nine. She rebuked him when he was 18. It's an involved story, but he'd been writing poems about her, but if you were a troubadour poet, which Dante in some sense was, you're supposed to obscure who it is you're writing about. And people had begun to suspect that Dante might have a thing for Beatrice. So he took on or pretended to take on with somebody else. Beatrice found out about it and she thought that Dante was being frivolous and cut him when he was 18. But you see, two, the number of duplicity and duality, 2 times 9, very bad. Dante would, of course, unmarried as he was at this point, have dearly loved to have married Beatrice. But that, sad to say, wasn't an option. Dante's family was in the lower nobility, but Beatrice's family was one of the two wealthiest banking families in Florence. Beatrice's dad, Folco Portinari, in fact, founded a hospital. He was a very charitable man and has left a very fine reputation behind. Founded a hospital in Florence that is still very much in operation. But Beatrice was out of Dante's league socially, sad to say, and she unsurprisingly wound up marrying the scion of the other great banking family, the Bardi family, and she married Simone de Bardi, and even sadder, died when she was 25. She should have died when she was 27. That's what Dante thought, because 27 is such a great number. I mean, you know, if 9 is good, 3 times 3, imagine how good and how Trinitarian 3 cubed is. 27. Unbelievable. Well, she symbolically fulfilled her 9-hood, her miraculous revelation-hood, in fact, by dying at 27. And after her death, Dante saw in a dream, and I don't doubt that he really did, a vision of her, after which he made the following promise, which concludes the Vita Nuova, which is his first big work, completed about 1294, a few years after Beatrice's death, in which Dante gathers together various sonnets and canzoni that he'd written about Beatrice and his relationship with Beatrice, and profoundly humble man that he was, glossed them and wrote an ongoing commentary and narrative to explain what he was thinking, to avoid the possibility of misinterpretation. Anyway, he concludes like this. There appeared to me a miraculous vision after Beatrice's death, in which I saw things that made me resolve to say no more about this blessed one, this Beatrice, so to speak, until I would be capable of writing about her in a more worthy fashion. And to achieve this, I'm striving as hard as I can, and this she truly knows, living soul in heaven that she is. Accordingly, if it be the wish of him through whom all things flourish that my life continue for a few more years, I hope to write of her that which has never been written of any other woman. It's a promise that Dante amply fulfilled in the Divine Comedy. Okay, so much for the story here. What does Beatrice mean to Dante? She functions to some degree in the Vita Nuova and overwhelmingly in the Commedia as her literal self, Beatrice Portinari, though there are people who have doubted that she existed. I find that hopelessly implausible, and so did the nearest contemporaries of Dante, and so did the earliest commentators. So I don't think really need to take that into account. What Beatrice means for Dante is this, I think. She is glossed as, explained as a symbolic figure representing grace, divine love, divine wisdom, revelation, and so forth, a whole range of qualities. Those are snazzy words. And we need, I think, in order to understand what Dante's up to and understand the power of his claims, to unpack them a little bit. Revelation ordinarily means what God shows us and is for Christians encapsulated particularly in the Bible and for Catholics in the church and in tradition, sacraments. Dante claims, though, remember that revelation can come from anywhere. And the implied claim in Beatrice is this. What may be objectively revelation, the Bible, let's say, the book of Numbers, let's say, may not be revelation for you if you read it. It may come across as just writing, and boring, ethnocentric, ferocious writing, or whatever it may be. Repressive writing, you may have been taken to church, or to temple, or to religious services of any kind as a child, and not felt the presence of God or the divine, but just been bored, and having to sit still and wearing scratchy clothes, and generally having a crummy time. Revelation to work, to have any effect, means the felt presence of God, the subjective presence of God, the phenomenological presence of God, God there for you and felt as such. And Dante implies through the figure of Beatrice that the way that comes to us varies from person to person. And until that comes to us, what may objectively be revelation, and for Dante, remember, finally, everything is objectively revelation in some sense, is not going to take on any kind of saving or enriching or enhancing life. It has to come through experience. Beatrice, as divine wisdom, as revelation, as grace, the gift from God, all of those things means, I think, finally, something like revelation for you. Whatever it is that makes religious life, your deepest yearnings, whatever it may be, fulfilled for you. That's why my students are so concerned with finding their Beatrice. And one once asked me, this was poignant, is it possible to miss your Beatrice? And I said, not by accident. You have to will it. And I think Dante would agree. That's what Beatrice means to Dante. The political situation, however, in which Dante lived was not inspiring, self-enhancing, transcendent at all. It is an ungenerous thing to remember, but a fact that vendetta is an Italian word, and the political situation in the Italy of Dante's day was marked by ferocious, venomous party strife. One instance of it, which Dante later on mentions, involved two families who are known to us from another context by a slightly different name, the Montecchi and the Capuletti, known to us as Montagues and Capulets, one Ghibelline, the other Guelph, the families giving rise to the protagonists in Romeo and Juliet. The basic divide, and this held in one sense or another for centuries in Italy, was between the Guelphs and the Ghibellines. The names derive from German Welfen, Weiblungen, and refer to factions within the Holy Roman Empire. Voltaire's joke was that it was not holy, not Roman, and not an empire, and there's some truth to that. But it was, even so, founded originally by Charlemagne and continuing to the time of Napoleon, it was, even so, a tremendous political power, especially in Germany and in North Italy. The Ghibellines were basically pro-imperial. The Guelphs stood behind the other political powers of the day, which in Dante's time were, first of all, the papacy, and behind that, France. In theory, the Ghibellines were originally the more aristocratic group, the Guelphs more focused on merchants. In all cities and in all areas where this party strife continued, it subsumed all kinds of personal family grudges and vendettas, and these often had much more to do with the political situation than the putative allegiance to Pope and Empire. Nonetheless, the contest between Pope and Empire was real and important, and Dante most emphatically took sides. Here's the political issue in a nutshell. On the one hand, especially after the very powerful Pope Innocent III, the papacy made the claim that because the Bishop of Rome was supreme over all Christendom, and Christ's vicar on earth, he should also be the political leader of the entire Christian cosmos. Kings were subservient to him just as they should be subservient to Christ himself. That's one claim. The Ghibelline claim is different. The Ghibelline claim says no. For the church to take political power is for the church to become corrupted by political and earthly concerns. Jesus was born under the Roman Empire for a reason. That was a divine validation of the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire, the Holy Roman Empire, was supposed to rule the world in a physical sense, in a holy way, for the benefit of people in this life, and the church was supposed to rule in a spiritual sense for the benefit of people in the life to come. There were, as the saying went, two sons, not one son, empire and papacy. That is what Dante came to believe. Paradoxically, though, and bear with me, this is very complicated, but there it is. He was a Guelph, but he was a white Guelph, which meant, in effect, a Guelph that was a Ghibelline. How could that be? Well, here's the story. Before Dante was born, the great rival, or one of the great rivals of Florence, and probably the most hated rival of Florence, Siena, which was strongly Ghibelline, and the Ghibellines in Florence took on the Florentine Guelphs at the Battle of Monteperti and thrashed them and threw the Guelphs out of the city. 6 years later, further south near Naples at the Battle of Benevento, and we'll talk about this in more detail later on, the Ghibellines were so thoroughly thrashed that they were not a power at all in Florence for the rest of Dante's lifetime. Florence was all Guelph. But rather like the Democratic Party in the days of FDR, there were Guelphs and Guelphs. Just like in FDR's time, there were Democrats, and then there were Southern Democrats who were, for most practical purposes, Republicans, but were Democrats because Lincoln had been a Republican and no white Southerner would vote for a Republican. So you have two different kinds of Guelphs. Dante, as a white Guelph, became, by the time he was 30, one of six priors of Florence, and that was the highest position. The term was very short, but it was nonetheless the highest position that you could take in the Florentine government as part of the White Guelphs. And he established a reputation, unsurprisingly, for independent-mindedness and probity and being kind of a difficult man to deal with. Meanwhile, the then Pope, Boniface VIII, made a request that Florence send troops to serve in the papal armies. How many divisions does the Pope have, asked Stalin? Well, in the Middle Ages, quite a few, often. Dante argued against it. That antagonized the Pope. A year later, he went on a mission to Rome to negotiate with Pope Boniface. While he was gone, Pope Boniface negotiated with the French, with the brother of the French King, Philip the Fair. And I realize this is complicated. Charles of Valois, to engineer a coup d'etat in Florence. While Dante, as part of the White Guelph government, was negotiating with the Pope working hand in glove with the French, had the White Guelphs thrown out of Florence at spear point, literally. Corso Donati, a relative by marriage of Dante, one of the Black Guelphs, working with Charles of Valois and the rest of the Black Guelphs, took control. Dante was exiled while he was gone, thrown out of office. All his property was confiscated. Fortunately, his wife had some independent property and was able, in diminished circumstances, to live. And Dante was condemned to death. If he went back to Florence, he'd be burned alive. The fabricated charge was graft or bribery. And Dante was an exile for the rest of his life. He died in Ravenna on the Adriatic coast south of Venice in 1321, 19 years later. So his world, kaboom, in one fell swoop, had come to an end. He had, in practical terms, lost his family. Beatrice, of course, was gone already. He had been on the top of the world, most famous poet in Italy, a leader in the Florentine government, bam, all gone. Now he is a condemned criminal, subject to burning if he is caught. It was, as you might imagine, a pretty embittering experience for him. He remained a white guelph and hoped for a white guelph restitution in Florence for a while. By the mid-1300s, 1304, 1305, he had been forced to give up on that. And then, as he says, he made a party of himself, increasingly Ghibelline in sympathy, with this difference. The Ghibellines were accused, and in some cases rightly, of being not just anti-papal, but in some sense irreligious, if not anti-religious. And Dante most emphatically was never that. But he did believe, and believed strongly, in the importance of life on this earth as well as in the life to come. He valued human capacity, reason, and so forth. As a follower of Thomas Aquinas, as a philosopher, he believed that there was no conflict between faith and reason, that reason could take you a long way and faith would take you further, but in the same direction. How could it be otherwise when God had made the world and God was the source of reason as well? And part of his Ghibelline commitment, his white guelph commitment, his commitment to empire, was a commitment to the importance of this life and into the integrity of the human person as constituted on earth. It took him a little while to find his feet, so to speak. He may or may not, I suspect not, but some early commentators thought otherwise. He may or may not have started the Commedia at the time of his exile. The vast majority of it was written afterwards. And beyond the Vita Nuova, which was already out at that time, he composed three other works post-exile, one of which he managed to finish. The one he managed to finish is a straight-up political explanation of why he thinks that monarchy, the empire, is necessary. And he wrote that there's a great deal of dispute, but sometime between, say, 1308, 1317, relatively late. He started two other works. He started two other works and got a third to halfway through them and then dropped them, although they're very substantial. One is his convivio, or banquet, symposium, if you will, in which he uses much the same format that he uses in the Vita Nuova to this extent. He writes poems and then comments on the poems. But the Convivio was meant to be a much more ambitious work. He was going to have 14 or 15 sections. He only completed four of them with canzone, with poems, and long, encyclopedic, very long, discussions of issues raised within it. At that time, people suspect Dante was interested in philosophy more than theology and to some degree in opposition to theology, following the famous works of a writer by the name of Boethius, The Consolation of Philosophy, which was likewise a work of verse and of straight prose exposition. He worked on that for a while, but it seems that as he really got rolling with the Commedia, he began to feel that the ends he had hoped to achieve in the Convivio were being more fully and more richly achieved there. Last work is called De Vulgare Eloquentia, which is basically about why it's a good idea to write and speak in Italian rather than Latin, which is basically a discussion of why it's a viable project to write seriously in Italian rather than Latin. The Commedia itself, of course, is in what becomes modern Italian, largely through Dante's own writing. His decision to write in Italian, though, was not obvious, and there were costs and benefits. The cost is you lose the international audience that Latin, as the Christendom-wide language of learning at the time, inevitably had. The advantage is you get a certain immediacy. But the problem was, there was no such thing as Italian exactly in Dante's day. There was Tuscan, Sicilian, Venetian, Milanese, whatever it may be. In fact, you can make an argument that there was a sort of Romance language continuum extending through Provence up into France, over into Spain and Portugal, Catalan, all kinds of Romance languages in a kind of spectrum, none precisely differentiated. The Italian that we come to know as literary Italian is a direct descendant of Dante's writing. That in itself is one of Dante's legacies. The Italian he chose, a modified Toscana, has become literary official Italian, changing over time, but nonetheless to this day. Well, in our next lecture, we're going to focus in more closely on what Dante is up to in the Commedia and on the large-scale structure of the Commedia before we hone in more closely on the beginning of his journey.
This ends Lecture 1. Dante and His Divine Comedy, Lecture 2, The Structure of the Commedia.
One of Dante's protectors in the later years of his exile, and a man whom he very much admired, was Cangrande della Scala. Wonderful name, big dog of the ladder, it means. And the della Scala family had been prominent in Verona and in northeastern Italy for a good long while. Dante was so grateful, in fact, that he dedicated the Paradiso to Cangrande, and though there is some dispute about its authenticity, a letter to Cangrande talking about the Commedia survives, which, whether it comes from Dante himself or not, and majority opinion is that it probably does, is about as close as we can get to Dante's own take, Dante's own commentary on the Commedia. There he claims this, that the goal of the Commedia, the purpose of the Commedia, is to lead men from a state of wretchedness into one of happiness. Now, he had lots of other goals, clearly, too. Self-aggrandizement, poetic fame is one, obviously, to some degree. I mean, for anybody who sets out to write an epic, to match Virgil, to reconceptualize the epic in Christian terms, all of those kinds of things. But this notion of leading people from wretchedness into bliss is something that Dante takes very seriously, and something that I think really does lie very, very close to the thematic heart of the Commedia. At the deepest level, then, I would argue that it is an allegory of salvation. That's what the Commedia is about, an allegory of salvation. Allegory is a word that gets tossed around a fair amount, and it's good to be clear, or as clear as we can be, about what it means. An allegory basically is a story which has symbolic meanings extending beyond the literal level. When I'm in a physical classroom, I often demonstrate this by claiming that I personally am tariffs and that one of my students is free trade and the prosperity of the nation, and then I walk over and pretend to strangle the student and say, okay, what's the meaning of this little visual allegory? And it's obviously a defense of free trade. Obviously, Dante's allegory is much, much more complicated than that, but it works in the same kind of way. It is fair to say, too, that the allegorical mode of thinking, which for us is kind of a stretch. It's not something that we do habitually, and it's not something that we're used to doing, was for the Middle Ages a kind of overarching mindset. It makes sense if you think about it. If the world, in all of its various particulars, is the physical instantiation or expression of the mind of God, then anything that you see also has a divine meaning too, inevitably, by the very nature of the case. And very, very influentially, and for 1,000 years before Dante's time, the Bible had been read in allegorical terms. This is so pervasive, again, to the medieval mindset, that it's worth giving an example or two to show how this process worked. Because this is the way, if you had gone on to higher education in a medieval context, this is the way you would have been trained in large part to think. From a Christian perspective, then, and from an allegorical perspective, when God parted the Red Sea and led Moses and the children of Israel through the Red Sea to the Promised Land, escaping the Egyptians, he really did that. And the Israelites really were the chosen people. And the pillar of fire was really there. All that's true. But, God had in mind another meaning as well. So, he was suggesting in advance, so Christian souls, the chosen souls of the redeemed, like the chosen people, would go through the Red Sea waters of baptism to the promised land of salvation, escaping the Pharaoh and the Egyptians, the demonic life that they had left behind. And that was deliberate. God chose to work that way. In the same way, the sacrifice of Isaac was a prefiguration for medieval Christian readers of Jesus' sacrifice on Calvary, and so on and so on and so on. The mindset is so pervasive, and this is astonishing stuff to read and amusing in its way. I mean, it's not, you know, a real knee slapper, but it's pretty strange. A writer as resolutely skeptical, and one might almost say flippant, as Ovid was read in heroically Christian terms in works like Ovidius Moralizatus, Ovid Moralize, which are slightly after Dante, but nonetheless suggest the kind of mindset at work. A real quick example of how that goes, the story of Perseus and Andromeda. Andromeda has been chained and is about to be devoured by a sea monster because her parents, Cephas and Cassiopeia, had boasted of her beauty and offended the gods. And Perseus, coming by with his winged sandals, carrying the head of Gorgon, goes down and rescues Andromeda. Well, gee, what could be more obvious? Cephas and Cassiopeia are clearly Adam and Eve. Andromeda is us, who has been given over to the sea monster Satan because of the sins of our fathers. And Perseus is clearly Jesus, who saves us, right? What could be more obvious than that? Look in the false sky and you'll see them all stellified. Hot stuff. Okay. With that kind of mindset out there, Dante is employing it. But his allegory in the Commedia works at many different levels. I can think of 4 main ones, and if we want to press it, 6. Here they go. Allegory 1. They're all allegories of salvation in one sense or another. 1, literal. The story itself. There was this guy, he was in a dark wood, then he went down a bunch of circles, and then he went up a bunch of circles, and then he went to heaven. The straight, flat narrative of the story. Which, as I suggested in the previous lecture, is a spiritual autobiography of Dante himself. It is, among other things, an account of how Dante dealt with the lostness of his situation after his life collapsed and found his way, so he claims, into a state of beatitude. But it's also, less prominently, but nonetheless, at times, importantly even so, an allegory of salvation history. That is to say, human history begins after the creation in the fall, proceeds through redemption, for Dante, through the incarnation and resurrection, right? And to the last judgment and to blessedness. That's in the Commedia too. More pertinently, and this is where we get very close to the meanings that Dante suggests in the letter to Cangrande. It's an allegory of the process of salvation, not just for Dante, not just for the human race as a whole, but for each individual person, anybody's process of salvation. Anybody's process of salvation is going to be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.